Hi there, and welcome back to another one of our online lectures here in World History. Today we're going to kick off the Middle Ages. We're going to talk about the causes of the Middle Ages and some of the major effects of the Middle Ages. I like to think of this story as an introduction, so we're going to set up a lot of the stories that we're going to talk about later on in the unit. So it's sort of the beginning. Now, there's a little think, pair, share that I usually do with my classes. I'm just going to throw this question out there because I think it's worth thinking about. The question is, if our American government disappeared today, how would our lives be different tomorrow, next month, or even next year? Now, on your notes handout, if you're in my course, there's a spot to write this down. And I usually do sort of a share out kind of thing. But I think if you're just listening to this and watching it online, just think about this question, because this really does apply to what happened to Europe once the Romans fell. So think about what would change if our American government disappeared. But anyway, that's just a sort of introductory question. Our constructive response question that really hits home with this particular topic says, describe the cause or causes of the Middle Ages, as well as several of the changes that occurred in Europe as a result. And we're going to go through many different examples that we can use to answer this question, should we choose to answer it on our test. So we'll be able to do that. So what will we learn? Well, we'll talk about what is the Middle Ages. We'll talk about some definitions, kind of how long it was, all of those different things. But then we'll really get into the heart of our topic here, which is the causes, and then we'll look at the effects or the changes that occurred during the Middle Ages. And again, it's an introduction. It really sets up our unit for us very nicely. So, what is the Middle Ages? Well, there's lots of identifying features. It's a long period. Some people think of feudal manors, like this city you see on the left. Some people think of the Crusades, like you see on the right. Some people think the bubonic plague. And you're not wrong in any of those things, because they all are a part of the Middle Ages. But there's so much more to it than just those events. So let's start with answering the question, what is the Middle Ages? So most historians think of the Middle Ages as the time period that existed between the Roman Empire and the Renaissance. Now, one thing that we really need to make sure we understand is this is Europe. This is not the whole world. There are many different places on the planet, many different civilizations that are continuing to thrive. But we know the Romans fell in 476 AD. And much like my question I posed to you a minute or two ago, well, what would happen if our American government disappeared? I mean, government disappeared when the Romans were gone. And that's going to lead to some major changes. Some of those changes are good. Many of them in short term are awful. And so we have to look at that. So again, this occurred in Europe. Others outside of Europe were thriving. And I've got a slide that's going to talk about some of the other groups that are continuing on, even as the Europeans are going through this Middle Ages. So again, it lasts about 1,000 years, roughly 500 to 1,500, and that's a rough estimate. Again, Rome fell in 476, and the Renaissance really starts in 1300 in Italy, but by the time it reaches all of Europe, you're looking at about 1,500. So again, those are just some rough estimates of 500 to 1,500. Some other names for this time period, you often hear it called the Dark Ages. We're going to see some clips from a History Channel series called the Dark Ages. Sometimes it's known as the medieval period. If you hear about medieval knights or medieval times, it's the same thing here in Europe. So different names that are associated with the Middle Ages. It's often seen as a very bleak and dangerous time, though. Starting with the fall of Rome, you know, those Germanic tribes came in. They couldn't read or write. They were often lawless. It was a very different way of life for Europe once the Roman continuity was gone. So the Middle Ages is not seen as a beacon of humanity or a wonderful time in history. So remember, this is isolated to Europe. So elsewhere in the world, China was thriving in its isolation, of course, until the Mongols come. Remember, we've already studied China and the Mongols, but we said that was much later on in history. China's history is a very long one. Though we didn't cover every facet of Chinese history, we did move far up into AD. So I just want to remind us of that. Japan grows by following China's example. We did talk about Japan a little bit. Several Islamic groups like the Ottomans There was others like the Umayyads and the Rashidins and eventually the Mughals and Safavids that all were thriving during this time period, even though Europe was in pretty rough shape. And of course, the Byzantine Empire was continuing to grow and was peaking. So I just want to make sure we understand that other groups are doing all right, Europe is not. So we talk about the causes, we talk about the effects of the Middle Ages. We have to start with the fall of Rome. And I found this little map that will show us a better look at this. So I'm going to let it reset itself here, and then we'll kind of see the effect that the fall of Rome has here on Europe. So bear with me as we wait for it to cycle back through to the fall of Rome. All right, here we go. So this is all the Roman Empire. It's still doing okay. Here it's divided. Diocletian divided it. But in 476, the Western Empire has fallen. See, it is gone. So all you have left is the Byzantine Empire, which, you know, comes and takes parts of Rome. But Europe really starts to change as we see that. We'll have different groups that come through. We're going to talk about the Franks and the Holy Roman Empire that will take over this part of Europe. So again, fall of Rome is where this story has to start. We use Jenga in my class to show the fall of Rome, so that should look familiar to my students. We saw this same animated GIF. So the final fall of the Western Roman Empire was caused by invading Germanic tribes. Look at that as the number one cause of the Middle Ages, and really the only cause that we're going to talk about here. So those invasions, though, led to a lot of major changes. Like, for example, we talked about disruption of trade. Merchant trade collapsed and Europe's economic centers were destroyed. Money also became scarce. Well, if your economic centers are destroyed, we're talking about your cities. So you have a downfall of cities that goes with this, too. So cities were abandoned as centers of administration. One statistic that I have seen is that the population of Rome went from 1 million people all the way down to 10,000, which is a 99% drop in population. So you're really looking at cities weren't safe anymore. That's where a lot of these Germanic peoples went, and if they needed food, if they needed water, they needed shelter, they often just took it. So it wasn't safe to be in the cities anymore. So that's going to disrupt trade and your overall economic centers. Because of that, Europe became rural. A lot of people went out and started little villages out in the countryside because, again, those cities weren't safe. So Roman cities were left without strong leadership, so people went out into the country. Well, what you're also going to get out of this is a decline in learning. The Germanic invaders could not read or write. That was not an emphasis that they had ever placed in their culture. It was not something that they ever focused on. So because of that, education became less important as people moved to rural areas. Basically, what ended up happening here as well is survival was number one. If you're ever in a situation where you need to find your next meal or you need to harvest your crops to get your next meal, or else you could die, you're going to abandon all extra activities, all leisure activities, including education. You're not going to learn to read and write if finding your food source is your number one priority. So you combine that with the culture of these Germanic peoples, and learning just starts to disappear. Not completely, but you really don't have schools and academics anymore. You're going to have a loss of a common language. Latin changed as Germanic peoples mixed with the Roman population. So these Roman people who spoke Latin are now going to be, there's going to be an influx of all these Germanic languages. So which will eventually combine and create these Romance languages, and we'll get Spanish and English and Italian, you know, the languages we associate with Europe today will eventually pop up. But we don't have that common language in Europe anymore. You get a loss of established government. Germanic tribes did not have written laws. They couldn't read or write. So they're not going to have written laws, which is going to be very difficult to create an orderly government for ruling purposes. I mean, one of the things that we've seen since the time of Hammurabi is that if you have written laws, those written laws are there for everybody to read. If you have only unwritten laws, like laws that people just know and speak, those things can be interpreted, they can be changed. But if a law is written, it's really hard to change. So you just have a real difficulty creating an established government without that. So how did the Middle Ages change Europe? What were some of the effects? Well, in a lot of ways, this is going to continue on what I was just talking about. Those Germanic invasions disrupted Europe and led to some changes. And we're going to double up on some of those here, but we're going to expand on some other ideas as well. So these are the changes or effects that come from the Middle Ages. So without Rome, of course, you're going to get new kingdoms to pop up. So we get new Germanic kingdoms that emerge. We're going to talk about the Holy Roman Empire that exists from the Frankish kingdom. So we're going to talk about who the Franks are and how that leads to the Holy Roman Empire. We're also going to talk about the feudal system. In the bottom right corner here, you see the feudal pyramid that we're going to act out in my class. It's very similar to the feudal system that we talked about in Japan, but it's got its differences too. So rise of the feudal system in Europe. Well, as things typically happen in history, as one group dies, another group steps in to assume power. And without real strong leadership through a good chunk of the Middle Ages, somebody had to step up and do it. And that's going to be the Catholic Church. So the power of the Christian, or in this case, the Catholic Church, is going to grow quite rapidly. So we're going to focus heavily on that as one of our learning outcomes in this unit. We're going to see how the church becomes a pretty big deal in Europe during the Middle Ages. So, of course, with that, the power of the popes grew rapidly. I mean, the pope leads the Catholic Church, so naturally the pope's going to gain a lot of power throughout this. Europe became rural. We talked about this. It wasn't safe to live in the big cities, so people went out to the countryside. That's where these feudal manors existed, and that's where feudalism was seen. But throughout Europe, you'll notice, if you ever do any traveling through there, like I've traveled through several European countries, and when we were in Italy, our tour guide said, "You notice the cities up in the hills?" And I said, "Yeah, you can see them. They're right up there. You can see the bell towers. You can see these churches up there." He said, "Well, that happened in the Middle Ages because it was safer to take the high ground. So you headed for the hills." Kind of like you see in this picture of these people running here. It wasn't safe to live in the cities, so they went out to the countryside or maybe up on hilltops to be safer. In some cases that worked, in some cases it didn't. We already talked about there was no major emphasis on formal education. There were some people who could still read and write, but you did not see many schools. Really the only place you could get an education for most of the Middle Ages was in the church, and we're going to talk about that with monasteries and convents. So the average person in Middle Ages Europe would not have had a formal education. Some more effects, new languages replace Latin. We talked about that one. Naturally, you're going to get English and you're going to get French and Spanish and the other languages we associate with Europe. But you're also going to have early signs of modern European countries that are going to start to appear. One of our learning outcomes in this unit is going to be the formation of Western Europe. And we're going to use both England and France as our examples here. We're going to kind of see how they establish some of their laws, some of the judicial systems, that become a cornerstone of what those two countries stand for today. But that's towards the end of the Middle Ages. So that brings us to the end. I mean, again, this is an introduction, kind of talking about how Europe changes as a result of the fall of Rome. So our result here is, without powerful leadership once provided by the Romans, Europe became a very different place. Economics changed, personal priorities changed, and culture changed. This would allow new groups to establish dominance in Europe, such as the Franks and the Catholic Church. And naturally, those are two topics we're going to talk about quite a bit as we move forward in our unit. So that brings us back to our constructive response question. It says, describe the cause or causes of the Middle Ages, as well as several of the changes that occurred in Europe as a result. We know the cause of the Middle Ages is the fall of Rome, but we just went through a long laundry list of different effects. Again, with the languages, with the loss of learning, loss of trade, loss of cities. We have a whole list of different things that we can use to answer this question. So, we're going to end there. That's going to do it for us. Hope you learned something. We'll see you next time.